Now, joining us this morning to talk about who won and who lost in yesterday's debate are Professor Edna Ko of the UP National College of Public Administration and Governance and Professor Julia Tihangi, the Dean of De La Salle University College of Liberal Arts. Good morning to you both, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
I just want to declare that I've got my notes with me and my documents. I hope this is not going to be taken against me.
You're fine.
Professor Ko, though, I understand that you were right there. You were in the audience. Tell us what the mood was like there yesterday.
Well, it was one of the more exciting political events and interchange that I have seen. The mood was really very, it was filled with emotion, both, I think, from the side of the candidates, even the TV host herself, and the audience especially. And I think that there was quite a lot of anxiety whether the debate was going to proceed, whether it was going to be canceled. And eventually, towards the end, after probably 45 minutes of waiting, the audience was already part of, you know, making a final decision. Like, I think Secretary Marr started it all. He said, there are rules to be followed here, and we should abide by the rules. This is an event which has been organized by Comelec, and that the candidates were simply invited, and therefore everyone should abide by the rules. And I think that statement was well appreciated by the crowd. And so I think maybe 95% of the crowd clapped their hands and started to cheer and chant and said, follow the rules, follow the rules. So I think it was quite an emotion-filled start, and that was really exciting by its own self behind the camera prior to the debate proper. And I think also the character of the candidate showed already.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I think that the debate really brought forth something that we rarely see among politicians.
Right.
And definitely, Professor Tihangi,
yes.
the character of the different candidates came out here. But how important really is character when choosing a leader?
Well, of course, when we choose our leader, especially the highest leader of the land, it is important for the electorate to see not only what the candidates have planned for the country, but also the character, because it is in their character that we can know and we can be assured that they will truly carry out whatever platforms or program that they say they will do.
So if we go over each of the presidential aspirants yesterday, starting with Vice President Jejomar Binay, what did his performance yesterday pre-fight and during the debate, what did it say about his character?
My summary of the entire second debate is that the vice president's tactics seem to be offense is the best defense. In order for him to defend himself against the allegation about corruption, he started hitting other candidates. For Senator Po, defense was the best offense. We saw a different side of Senator Po. She was channeling her inner FPJ. No? So we saw that side of Senator Po that we thought did not exist. And then for Mayor Duterte, no offense for that night because of her his strong image that's been not resonating with the independent voter. So he tried to soften his image. And then for Secretary Marr, it was all defense because he was not simply defending his own track record, but that of the administration as
but
well.
But what was the character trait that emerged the most with Vice President Binay that we don't often get to see?
Well, actually, what we saw in the debate was simply part of it. What was more interesting was the outtake that they showed after.
And what were your thoughts on that?
In this day and age of reality TV, that was political reality TV. And we saw how they actually behaved, and they were not conscious that this was going to be broadcasted later on. So we really saw how they behaved normally. And I think this will not go well with Vice President Binay's survey ratings.
At a certain point, when they were discussing the issue of whether or not he could use his notes, I remember that he was shaking his fists in the air when he was trying to ask Senator Poe to let him speak first. Is that something that's surprising given the image of the vice president that we've seen all these years?
Yes, of course. We have a saying in Filipino, ang pikon talo. No? So actually, last night's debate was a contest of who will not lose his or her cool. And apparently some of them at some point lost it, right? Okay.
Professor Kwa, do you think, though, that the vice president was able to respond to the corruption allegations, or is this something that still hasn't been put to bed? I mean, we knew that this was the main issue, really, that was going to be brought up against the vice president. How well did he handle it?
I think in the beginning, I thought that VP Binay was confident that he can quell the issues very well, that he was confident that he was going to argue, which he actually did. He was arguing based on the legality of the allegation and said there is nothing yet there, really. He was trying to put it across so many times. But I think simply the argument of all three candidates, the other competitors, really, they were trying to pin him down. And I think in the end, he simply, by people's perception and the way he defended himself, or not quite effectively defended himself, was that people still hang on to the idea that there is a reason for suspicion.
On the flip side of it, I agree with you. I did see that the three other candidates were all trying to pin him down on the corruption allegations. But on the flip side, do you think that perhaps his supporters might take that as the three of them ganging up on the poor candidate?
Well, I think that's part of the whole debate issue, that sometimes the issue is tied up to really how well the candidate would be able to rise above the obstacle, rise above the issue that is being hurled against someone. And that's the whole issue, that's the whole spirit of a debate. How well do I handle myself in explaining and convincing that indeed I am or I am not? So I think in the end, as I said, people still have those suspicions hanging in their heads. And to a certain extent, maybe I would say VP Binay lost in that sense. And I think there's a triumph of the competitors. And what other people, would say, he's not really cleared after all. There's a sword hanging over his head. And that should, take a second caution on the part of the voters to say, am I not going to be trustful of such a candidate?
Let's talk about Senator Grace Poe. Yes. What do you think her performance in last night's debate taught us about her character?
I think she's the modern Filipino Gabriela. Although we say, well, she probably is the, if ever, if when she wins, she will be probably the first Filipino, first lady, well, first woman American president, which is a joke that's going around.
Right.
But I think she showed how vigorously she's arguing, and she's so showing the character of a strong modern Filipina, putting up the issues and confronting three male competitors. So I think that's a good thing for her. But to what extent she will succeed in convincing voters that indeed she's worthy of being in that highest position. Gigi, the highest position is something else. It's a post above the others.
Right.
And so there is an additional expectation from people.
Right.
We have to remember that Senator Poe is the only real debater among the four. She was actually a debater in her college years.
Okay.
So technique-wise, during the first debate we saw it, but this time she came out really, really hard and strong. And I think she's playing out to the other side of the electorate, that demographic that is attracted more or less to Mayor Digong Duterte.
But she sort of lost her cool at some point early on, especially when the issue was raised by Vice President Binay about her citizenship. He said, you pledged allegiance to the United States.
Abjure.
And
he said, Goebbels.
You're not right. And he said, you're not an OFW. And then she kind of lost her cool a bit, which is something we never see with Senator.
That's to be expected because she's been enduring that charge for how long since last year. So I mean, we can cut her some slack with that because that was really a very personal and emotional issue.
Now, the issue that's been raised against Senator Poe, apart from the citizenship issue, has always also been about her inexperience.
Okay.
But how well do you think she responded
I think she responded well because she is running as an outsider. The reason why she is resonating in the polls is because the two other major candidates, or the three other major candidates, are insiders. Oh, aside from Mayor Digong Duterte, Grace Poe and Duterte are the outsiders in this race. We have two establishment candidates, one with the opposition, one with the administration. And she's running as an outsider. And her inexperience is, in fact, a plus factor for her candidacy.
But how, Professor, how well do you think she responded to the question of Mayor Duterte, where he asked her, if late in the night you get a phone call and you find out that the Philippine Coast Guard has been attacked by in the West Philippine Sea, then how would you respond to that? What did you think of the answer that she gave to that?
Well, in the first place, I think Digong Duterte posted a very macho question to a woman who he thought wouldn't be able to respond. But I think, she did well, too. She's firm, she's convinced, and she has the character of really a potential leader, but on the other hand, to be more realistic, if she says, I'm first a mother to this nation, then somehow, you know, that puts the feminine side of her as a leader.
But as a viewer, my expectation was that she was going to say, I'm going to convene the National Security Council.
Right.
I don't know, maybe that's just me.
That's
but what she said was, I'm going to call the AFP and I'm going to call the DOTC chief. What did you think of that, sir?
Well, I think that reveals a weakness on her part in terms of her policy, her broad policy understanding, especially foreign policy and national security. I agree with you, Gigi. My first response would have been, I will call for the National Security Council and ask for an immediate briefing on the matter. And then the second would be to contact our key allies, and third might be even to invoke the Mutual Defense Treaty. Those were the three main answers.
But I thought that is coming from the fact that she's the least familiar with the Philippine government operation and processes, and she's the least among them. She's the least familiar on the Philippine bureaucracy and the functioning, I mean, which particular unit of government is responsible. And I think that's where her being, you know, a newcomer in the game is, you know, hurting her. Yeah. If you would say, well, she didn't know that she first has to consult the proper authorities.
Right.
And this is not the first time that she slipped on that. So I thought, I mean, someone from public administration, I would say, oh no, that's not the proper body that she should be called.
Of course, she is not the first junior senator to run for the presidency. You have Barack Obama in the United States, you have Noynoy Aquino here. So, of course, but she is also adept with policy issues because if ever she gets elected, she will be the first political scientist to become president.
Having a look at what was going on social media during that part of the debate, it seemed that there were some netizens who were really trying to pin down her inexperience because there were those who were pointing out, well, she thinks that the BUB is only now being implemented.
Right.
And there's the other part where on social media they were saying that, well, she thinks that the PIDEA is under the DILG.
Exactly.
So it looks like they were really trying to you know, to see if she could sort of disprove all of this connotation that she is inexperienced.
So this is a challenge for her to really show that she can learn all of this in time for her election if ever she becomes lucky.
What about Secretary Marrojas? I think it's already common knowledge that he's picon. I mean, that's the general perception of him. But what new thing did we learn, or did it just reinforce this notion of him, Professor Tihangki?
Okay, Secretary Mar, his main weakness would always be the failure to connect emotionally to the electorate, to the voters. And last night, I noticed that he was able to connect finally, yes, especially during his last statement. No? He was able to connect and trying to actually concretize his vision of decency, rule of law, a rule-based society, a society where there's equality in terms of government service, walang singitan, walang jumper. So I believe he's taking a play or two from Pinoy's game book, no, rule book, in which instead of saying that hindi ako corrupt, I am a decent man. So which is actually part of the entire reformist good governance narrative.
So when he kept on saying, no notes, let's follow the rules, yeah, no notes allowed, and also this is my time, oras ko to, yes, you think that actually worked in his favor?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And Professor Ko, do you think though that he was able to answer that one big criticism that we keep hearing, which is the criticism that the administration has selective justice, it doesn't go after its allies? How well did Secretary Rojas respond to that?
I think in last night's debate, Secretary Mar succeeded in putting the blocks together, which means he was able to see and to make the public understand there are failures of the administration, mm-hmm, but there are successes. There are criticisms against the administration, but he also tried to be the good knight and the good person of the administration by being an insider, and therefore he was able to put the figures and the facts, and I think that sounded very convincing. So I thought that for the first time I heard him speak, he succeeded in putting things convincingly and say, well, this is the criticism, but this is what we tried to do. We're not perfect. And I think that went very well. He was also cool, and he was also trying to be as decent as possible, something like rising above the rough accusations and even the harsh words, no? The description that was thrown at him.
There were a few times where I think he might have lost his cool. I think it was really because Mayor Duterte, I think he was the favorite one.
Exactly.
That, you know, Mayor Duterte always wanted to taunt Secretary Rojas. And I think particularly the part where he was talking about, Mayor Duterte was saying that you cannot be a good leader if you are not ready to die for your country.
Yes.
And he said, you're pretentious. He said, you're weak.
Yes.
So I felt there as a viewer that Secretary Rojas sort of lost his cool there. What are your thoughts on that, Professor Tihangki?
Yes. Well, because they're friends, I think Mayor Duterte knows which button to push in order for to get the appropriate reaction from Secretary Mar. And I think he succeeded in doing that. And especially when the attack was actually personal regarding his Wharton degree,
right,
which of course Goebbels comes to mind here, because you keep repeating that story, it will, you know.
So he got a little bit defensive
defensive. And but in fairness to Secretary Mar, to Secretary Mar and Vice President Binay got the bulk of all the attacks. No? At one point it was all Binay, then second it's all Mar. But I think Secretary Mar performed better than Vice President Binay in defending himself and explaining himself to the public.
Okay. What do you think, finally, of Mayor Rodrigo Duterte?
Mayor Rodrigo Duterte was like a choir boy. No? He was behaved, but he was naughty. No? Naughty and behaved. So he's, you know, that goes into his image. No? That is his image, and, you know, he's a pilyo. No, yeah, to put it in Filipino, no, pilyo siya. You know, he's like a lascador also. No, he's just there throwing, some one-liners.
You say choir boy. I think he was more like a stand-up comedian, especially the pre-fight or before the debate actually began. But how important is that really to the Pinoy voters to see that side of him?
Because his core supporters are essentially attracted to him because of his top guy, anti-crime macho image. But this is not getting any traction beyond Mindanao, beyond his core demographics. He needs to attract the independent voters, those who are not convinced that he will, you know, he will be a good president. But I don't think, despite the fact that he was behaved last night, the very fact that he mentioned killing again, you cannot be a president unless you're willing to die or you're willing to kill, again, brings out the red flag among the minds of the independent voters that really, can we really trust this guy to become president?
So you think that this charming side of him that he showed last night, that's not going to be enough to maybe convince
some voters?
Every time
he insists that there should be some form of violence during his presidency, I don't think he will be able to attract the independent voters.
Professor Kod, the main issue that was asked of him yesterday was in reference to something that he had said in a previous debate, which is that in 6 months, he's going to be able to rid the country of criminals and corruption. How well do you think he responded to the challenge as to whether or not he could actually really do that?
Well, actually, I read it to mean like, I'm a decisive person. I can do things and I will do it surely. On the other hand, come on, give it a second thought. Can you really do it in 3 to 6 months? You must be kidding. If you've done it in Davao, maybe not for the whole country, because scale here matters quite a lot.
Yeah.
And I think that becomes less convincing. But I think you should give credit to the guy for saying, for delivering the message that I'm really firm and decisive.
But he didn't give details.
No details.
I mean, but there is, really, there are no details to it. Which is why I said the more challenging part is, can you really tell me how you're going to do it? I mean, give him the what he accused the administration about dealing with the national prison. Put him there and give him the test. And I don't think that would be easy to take up in 3 months' time.
Right.
So I think if you challenge him on the how-tos, really, in a time frame as what you know, he promised, that will be his biggest challenge.
You know, the devil is in the detail,
right.
Even
exactly.
For a devil.
Okay. Exactly. So I think that last night what viewers would have wanted to hear were concrete steps as to how he was going to achieve that promise.
Yeah.
And
right.
I didn't hear it, and it looks like you guys didn't hear it either.
And even those who are adept at the issue of peace and order and crime, Senator Ping Lacson himself, have already stated that it's impossible to be done in 3 to 6 months unless you do something really, really drastic.
But you know, he's a banterer, so he can always say, no, I mean, it's a joke, you know.
But then again, he's running for the president and
exactly.
It's no joke.
He gave so many great sound bites, but did he actually raise any substantial points throughout the debate?
Well, throughout the debate, he was the one who went most off topic, you know, so they were already discussing very substantive policy issues, then he would throw up a one-liner and then everything else would go all right.
What do you think that says about him?
Again, that plays to his weakness rather than his strength. So he should recalibrate.
I think Christian Izguera in our Rockwell studio wants to ask some questions. All right, okay. I think there's some technical difficulties.
Okay.
You know what? To wrap it up, what I really want to know is who do you think, you know, ended up as the winner in this debate? There's three debates all in all.
Yes.
This is round two,
round two, so to speak. Right.
Professor Kwai, I want to start with you. Who do you think emerged as the winner here?
I think for all the degree of allegations and trying to overcome it and defend it and put forward the counter argument and the convincibility, if there is a word such as that, I think it would be Secretary Mar, who performed very well last night. I think if you put it on the other hand, I think VP Binay suffered in last night's exercise. The two Duterte and Senator Grace po, I would put them on a tie in the middle with their own characteristics and brand of defense and debating, but a little bit of an edge there for Senator Po.
What about you, Professor Fihanki?
Okay, my scorecard.
Yeah, what's in your scorecard?
My scorecard, just like in the first debate, I think the second round goes to both Senator Po and Secretary Mar Rojas. They were good debaters. They came prepared. They were more or less, they had their figures with them. And they did not bring any notes. So that's the most important part.
That's an important part.
For then, Mayor Duterte was able to soften his image. And we saw the more charming, funny side of Mayor Duterte. I think the major loser for the debate last night was really Vice President Binay. Especially, he did not need this drama with the notes and everything. I mean, this shattered his narrative that he is the most experienced among all of them. Because if you're experienced, then you should have all of this in your mind and you don't need any notes. So this entire drama hurt his chance, and we will see this in the next round of survey. Right.
Well, it's not over until the fat lady sings. There is one more debate. That's the ABS-CBN Manila Bulletin debate that's happening in April. So we hope that you can come back again and give us a post analysis of that debate. But for now, thank you so much for coming over.
Thank you for having us here.
Thank you.